بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين، وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. We ask Allah Ta'ala to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired. Ameen. Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention, our heart, to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. In our lesson tonight, we'll continue talking about some of the conditions for the validity of the prayer. The prayer has conditions, prerequisites. It has integrals, requisites, without which one's prayer is invalid. And there are also the invalidators of the prayer. One needs to be aware of these matters in order to make sure that his prayer is performed in a valid manner. Otherwise, performing what looks like performing the prayer, while in fact one is missing out one of the conditions or one of the integrals, is not enough. For this reason, the Prophet ﷺ asked the man who performed the prayer in his mosque and came to give salam to the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet replied and instructed him to go back and pray, because he hasn't really prayed. He didn't perform the prayer in a valid manner. He went back three times. Every time the Prophet used to instruct him to go and pray a valid prayer. Then he said to the Prophet, "I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who sent you truly to us, I don't know how to pray except the way you saw me praying." The Prophet ﷺ did not leave him in the way he used to perform the prayer, which was an invalid prayer. Rather, he taught him how to pray from the beginning till the end. That's why it's very important for the one who is performing the acts of worship to learn about the conditions, to learn about the integrals, and to learn about the invalidators, so he can perform the conditions and the integrals, and he would avoid as well the invalidators, to make sure the act of worship one is performing is in a valid manner. Among the conditions of the validity of the prayer is for one to direct one's chest towards Qibla. When the Prophet ﷺ performed the prayer before Kaaba, he was directing his chest towards Al-Kaaba, which is that physical cubic shape in Mecca. And Mecca, if you check on the map, it's in the center of the world. All Muslims around the world, when they pray, they face Al-Ka'bah. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed before Al-Ka'bah, towards Al-Ka'bah, he said, "This is Al-Qibla. This is Al-Qibla." And Allah Ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to face the Kaaba, and also ordered the believers to face the Kaaba wherever they are. So wherever one is, he needs to face the Kaaba, as this is the direction of the prayer. What is meant by facing the Qibla is to face the Kaaba, and what is parallel to it, to the seventh sky, and what is parallel to it, below the Kaaba, to the seventh earth. Because the one who is in the plain and he needs to pray, he will be above the Kaaba. The one who is in Mecca, in one of the high-rise buildings, the Kaaba will be below him. So he's not going to face it that way. He's going to face that space above the Kaaba. So he would see where the Kaaba is located and the space above it, and will face that direction. When one is standing, he will be facing the Kaaba by his chest. Same when he is sitting for tashahud. And when one is in his ruku' or sujood, he will be facing the Kaaba with most of his body. Most of his body will be towards the direction of the Kaaba. The scholars of Islam said, one needs to learn the ways how to determine the direction of the Kaaba. You might be in a place where you need to pray and you need to find out the direction of the Kaaba. So you need to do what is called ijtihad. Ijtihad, to put effort using acceptable means to find the direction of the Kaaba. The scholars of Islam agreed that the strongest means to determine the direction of the Kaaba is through the stars. In the northern hemisphere, people will look at the North Pole. The North Pole will give them always the direction of the true north. By finding the true north, they can determine the other three directions. From north, they find south, east and west. And it depends where they are located from the Kaaba. They need to face the Kaaba. So this is the Kaaba in the middle of the earth. If one is east of Kaaba, he needs to face west. If one is west of Kaaba, west of Mecca in general, if he's far away, he needs to face east. If one is north of Mecca, he needs to face south. And if one is south of Mecca, he needs to face north. If one is in the direction of southeast, southeast, like in Australia, Australia is located southeast of Mecca, then he needs to face northwest. Northwest will be the direction of the Kaaba. So from the stars, one may determine the direction of the Qibla. In the southern hemisphere, also from the stars, he can determine where is the South Pole, which is located in the true south, and he can determine from that the north and the west and he will face northwest, and that would be the direction of the Qibla. If one has tried trusted compasses and found them to be reliable, he can rely on them as well to find the direction of the Qibla. If he is in a park, in a place, he trusted the compass, he tried it, he can use it to find the direction of the Qibla as well. From the shadow of zenith, we know how to determine the direction of the Qibla as well. When the sun is in the middle of the sky, we'll have the shortest shadow of any object. And as you know, the sun moves from east to west. So at 90 degrees, so you have 180 degrees. At 90 degrees, that's when the sun is at its zenith. The shadow will be facing north-south. From that shadow, one can determine the four directions and he can find the direction of the Qibla. That's another way of finding the direction of the Qibla. So the strongest means of determining the direction of the Qibla is through the stars. And the weakest means is through winds. They determine the direction of the Qibla. One cannot simply be in a place not knowing the direction of the Qibla and he would assume the Qibla is in that direction or that direction and pray without making that kind of ijtihad, making effort to find the direction of the Qibla. You find many people in different places when it comes to prayer, they don't know how to find the direction of the Qibla. Although these days it has become easier through compasses, if they have devices that rely on satellite and the like, where they can find the direction of the Qibla, they can do that. But not to make any kind of ijtihad and to pray assuming the Qibla is in this direction or that direction, that's invalid. In the past, they used to be more careful. So if you go to an old mosque, 300-400 years built from that time, scholars went to that mosque and prayed in it. So you know that they checked it. It has been checked by trustworthy people, scholars. So you can rely on it to find the direction of the Qibla. I know a building in Lebanon. The building was built in a way, this way, so it was southwest, where the direction was supposed to be southeast. But because the building is built in that way, and it's under the ground, so they kept it as is, and they put the mihrab, that cavity, or they build something, they put it in the same way the building is directed to. Now, if you were to pray in that place, you will see that you need to change to the right direction of the Qibla. That is needed because it's among the conditions of the validity of the prayer is to face Al-Kaaba. Either by seeing Al-Kaaba, if you are in Mecca and you see the Kaaba, you face it. Wallah, we've seen people in Mecca, in the mosque, Al-Haram Mosque, on level 1 or 2, that building around the Kaaba. So it's in the mosque. They stand and they don't face the Kaaba. They don't face the Kaaba. They don't make that simple effort, it's in front of them, to find the direction of the Qibla. They can see the Kaaba and they don't face it. If one is away from Al-Ka'bah by a little bit, let us say a few buildings. He cannot see the Ka'bah, and trustworthy people tell him, yeah, before all these buildings were built, the Ka'bah is in that direction. He can take with the statement because they saw the Ka'bah. Now it's easier as well. See that building with the clock on the top? This can be seen from far away. So even if you are far away, you can see that building with the clock on the top. You know the direction of Kaaba. Now it can be seen from Arafat. If you are in the land of Arafat, you can still see the clock tower and you can know the direction of the Qibla. The second condition is the setting in of the time of the prayer. By visual observation, if one can, so he might rely on observing the sun, and we explained before how would one determine the times of the prayers from the sun, from the shadows, and so on. When the sun is in the middle of the sky, we said we have the shortest shadow of an object. Once the sun declines westward, that shadow starts getting longer and it starts moving to the east. That's when the time of Zuhr prayer sets in. When the length of the shadow is equal to the length of the object plus the shadow of the object when the sun was at its zenith, then the time of Asr prayer has set in. Imam Abu Hanifa, however, did mention twice the length of the object. But according to the majority of the scholars, they call them Al-Jumhur, they said when the shadow becomes equal to the length of the object plus the shadow when the sun was at the middle of the sky, the time of Zuhr prayer has finished and now it's the time for Asr prayer. When the disk of the sun disappears in the horizon or below the horizon, that means the time of Maghrib prayer has set in. After sunset, you see redness in the horizon. When that disappears, it's time to pray Isha and the time for Maghrib prayer has finished. When the true dawn is seen from the east and it is a white illumination of light that is horizontal, not vertical, horizontal. You can see it across the horizon. It starts as thin, then it expands. As it is expanding, you can see it's becoming brighter and brighter. Then the sun rises afterwards. When that thin whiteness in the eastern horizon that is horizontal appears, that means the time of Subh prayer has set in. So one needs to learn how does the time of each prayer set in to make sure to be performed within designated times. Because Allah Ta'ala said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. Allah ordained the five obligatory prayers upon the slaves, the believers, to be performed within designated times. If you pray after the designated time, it will be classified as a makeup. If you pray ahead of its setting time, it's invalid. Like now, if you were to pray the subh for tomorrow, it's invalid. But now if you have missed out praying Maghrib and now you pray Maghrib, it will be classified as a makeup. So one needs to perform each prayer within its designated time. So you would rely on either the visual observation, like you looked for instance in the west and you saw that the sun has set completely, disappeared, the disk of the sun disappeared below the horizon, now you can pray Maghrib. So it's either by observing this, or sometimes you might have what they call it strong approximation that can be a method of having a habitual wird, praises, supplications, Quran recitation, that you know that once you finish them, the time of the following prayer would have set in. Let us say, for instance, you pray Maghrib. You pray 3 rak'ahs, that's the obligation. Then you pray 2 sunnah rak'ahs. Then let us say a person has a habit to stay sitting down, reciting Surah Al-Mulk, Surah Al-Waqi'ah, making supplications, praises. And he tried it many times that by the time he finishes his wird, that's called wird, it could be a collection of zikr, supplication, and Quran recitation, or of one type. Once he finishes, he knows that the time of Isha prayer would have set in. So he can rely on it after he tried it. So if he has this habit to recite his wird after Maghrib, and by the time he finishes his wird, he knows that the time of Isha prayer has set in, he can get up and pray Isha. So he relied on that strong approximation in that case. The third condition is to be Muslim. To be Muslim is the first condition for one's act of worship to be valid. Because the one who is not Muslim, performing any of the acts of worship won't be valid from him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, in many explicit verses, that in order for one's acts of worship to be valid, one has to be a believer. So that's the first thing. So in order for any of the acts of worship to be valid, one must be a believer. If he is not a believer and he wants to outwardly pray or fast, that won't be accepted from him. That's why if one were to approach you and he's non-Muslim and he says, I want to pray, teach me how to pray, you tell him, first you need to embrace Islam, after that you pray. If he says, I want to fast, as you do, you say the first condition for the validity of the fast is for one to be a believer. So without having the correct belief in Allah and His Messenger, one's acts of worship won't be valid. Imagine someone believes that Allah is a body with limbs and organs, and then he says, I want to pray. So when he's standing in the line saying Allahu Akbar to pray, he is worshipping this image that he imagined in his mind. So he's not worshipping Allah, he's worshipping an image that he imagined, something that is a body with limbs and organs, and he's worshipping this image. So how would his act of worship be valid? It will never be valid in that way. Al-Ghazali said, لا تصح العبادة إلا بعد معرفة المعبود. One's act of worship won't be valid except after one has the correct belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one rightfully worshipped. So he needs to learn, because if one were to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a human being and he wants to pray as Muslims do, no, Muslims are worshipping Allah, the creator of human beings, and this person is worshipping a creation, so it won't be valid. Or if someone believes that the sun is God or the moon is God and he wants to pray as Muslims do, it won't be valid from him because he is not worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people who do not acquire the knowledge about religion, they remain ignorant and they would have a mixture of beliefs in their hearts, especially what pertains to God, and they won't have the proper belief in God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not resemble the creations in any way whatsoever. Allah is not a body, Allah is the creator of bodies. Allah is not a human being, Allah is the creator of human beings. Allah is not an angel, Allah is the creator of angels. Allah is the creator of this whole universe, and Allah does not resemble anything of this universe. So one must have the correct belief in his heart in order for his prayer to be valid. Also, the child must have attained the age of mental discrimination, where he can understand the question and can respond properly to that question. That when he is in a state of tamyiz, a child that is 2-3 years old, for instance, is not mumayyiz. Sometimes you might see a child seeing his father praying, he would stand next to him and would start imitating the father in bowing down and going to sujood and the like. His prayer is invalid. He doesn't know what he's doing. And that's why you do not tell the child, get up and pray at this age, 2, 3, or even 4, if he's not mumayyiz. Once he reaches tamyiz, the age of mental discrimination, he can understand the question, he can comprehend it, and he can respond properly as well. You teach him how to make wudu, how to pray, because now it is valid from him. Also, amongst the conditions is to deem the obligatory prayer an obligation. And that means for one praying an obligatory prayer to know that it is obligatory. A person may embrace Islam and he might be afterwards performing a prayer like Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, or Subh without deeming this prayer as an obligation. His prayer wouldn't be valid in that case. He must deem that obligatory prayer an obligation in order for his prayer to be valid. Of course, if one knows that these 5 prayers are obligations and he denies the obligation of these 5 prayers out of arrogance, he is not a believer. But someone embraced Islam, he doesn't know this prayer is an obligation and he prayed it, it won't be valid unless he deems it an obligation. Also, amongst the conditions not to deem any of the integrals of the prayer as a recommended matter, sunnah. According to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, there are 17 integrals for the prayer. Fatiha, reciting the Fatiha, is one of the integrals. Ruku' is one of the integrals. Sujood is one of the integrals. So in the prayer, if one is praying according to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, and he doesn't deem reciting the Fatiha as an obligation, his prayer is not valid. So he needs to deem as obligatory all the integrals of the prayer according to that mazhab. Also, to cover with what conceals the color of the skin of the whole body of the free woman, with the exception of her face and her hands. So for ladies, what they need to cover in the prayer, the whole body, except for the face and the hands, up to the wrist. For men, the area between the navel and the knees, it should be covered. It should be covered with a type of fabric that conceals the color of the skin. The scholars gave an example that if one is wearing a kind of fabric, but one can still, by looking at this fabric, he can know whether this person has a dark skin or a white skin and the like, so it can be recognized. That is not enough. That is not enough. And the covering, the scholar said, will be from all sides except from underneath. What does that mean? When one is wearing clothes, let us say he is wearing like that long piece of garment, this one. This one is open from the bottom. It's not like sewed from the bottom, of course. No one would be, you know, walking in a sack, for instance. From underneath, it's open, but from the top and all the sides, it's covered. So if one were to look from the sides or from the top, he can't see a part of the prohibited nakedness. But let us say, if someone is wearing that long piece of garment, we call it abaya, and praying on the top of a hill, if someone is looking from underneath, he might see his thigh, for instance. Yeah, but from all the sides and from the top, he's covered. That is sufficient. He doesn't have to cover from underneath the prohibited nakedness. So since, for instance, the prohibited nakedness of a man is between the navel and the knees, if he is wearing a long piece of garment below his knees, that is sufficient. That is sufficient. For ladies, since they have to cover the whole body, except for the face and the hands, that piece of garment needs to go to the ground. So underneath the ankles. So if she's wearing, let us say, a skirt, that is not sufficient. Even if she's wearing socks underneath her, but that skirt is not enough. It needs to go below the ankles. Now we'll talk about the invalidators of the prayer after we talked about the conditions. Prayer is invalidated by speaking words that people usually converse with. Like when you ask someone about something, you talk to a person, how are you? And he replies. That kind of conversation between two people, this kind of talk invalidates one's prayer. However, making zikr, such as to say Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, this is zikr, does not invalidate one's prayer. Because the prayer itself is a set of praises. So you can praise Allah at any time in the prayer, and that does not invalidate your prayer. You say La ilaha illallah, Subhanallah. You can recite Quran, this does not invalidate your prayer. You can make supplication, ask Allah Azza wa Jal to forgive you and the like. This does not invalidate your prayer. So if one voluntarily talks with something that people converse with one another, that invalidates one's prayer. Even by uttering two letters. Now, some people when they are in pain, they use some expressions that usually a person would utter with when he is in pain, such as to say, "Ah," or ah, for instance. These are two letters. That, if done on purpose, voluntarily, that invalidates one's prayer. Not when it happens involuntarily, like someone is in the sujood, as he was raising up to the standing position, he had the back pain, and he had that sharp pain when he was standing. So involuntarily, he said, ah, for instance. It came out involuntarily, that does not invalidate his prayer. Even the scholars said, even if one were to utter one letter, but that has a meaning, that contains a meaning, then one's prayer is invalidated. In Arabic, sometimes you might use a letter, one letter, but it means something. So if one were to say, let us say, he saw someone about to trip over, and he said to him, for instance, Sa'i. Sa'i, that's one letter, Ayn, with Kasra. Sa'i. It's like he's warning him. Yeah, that one letter invalidates his prayer. Unless one forgot that he's praying and he uttered with few sentences, then it won't be invalidated. When we say few sentences, meaning not to have a long dialogue with someone because he forgot that he is in the prayer. Few sentences. Let us say you were praying, and as you were praying, someone or your mother was calling you. Where did you put that thing, for instance? And involuntarily, because you forgot, you said to her, it's in the cupboard. So you mentioned few words, but that won't invalidate your prayer. That will not invalidate your prayer, because that is classified as few. Even if you mention, let us say, two sentences or three, that is still classified as few words, such as to say, I don't know, ask my brother. That is classified as little amount of words. If they happen involuntarily when one is praying, his prayer remains valid. Some people wouldn't know that if they are praying, they cannot talk with what they converse with one another. So that's why one needs to learn about these matters. Even the scholar said, if someone is a new convert, he embraced Islam recently, and he started praying, but he hasn't learned yet that he cannot talk with such words. And he was praying, and he talked with these words while praying. The scholar said his prayer remains valid. So we teach him, when we hear him next time, you cannot talk with such a talk when you are praying. We teach him. Also amongst the invalidators of the prayer, to make many moves. To make many moves, that would be classified as too much or too many moves. What is classified as too many moves and what is classified as little movements in the prayer? The scholars in the Shafi'i school said what is classified as too many is for one to perform consecutively movements with the large organs that would last for a duration of performing one rak'ah. So if one were to pray one rak'ah, to recite the Fatiha, go for ruku', then i'tidal, then sujood, then sitting, then sujood, then standing up, a duration of performing one rak'ah, that's a long time. Some Shafi'i scholars said, what is classified as too many moves is what is done consecutively for a duration of one rak'ah. Other scholars said three consecutive moves is classified as too many. Others said to identify the too many moves, are the ones that if you look at this person, you won't think he's praying. For instance, making three steps. Someone was in the mosque, then he made three steps, like one, two, three. Three steps. When you see this person making three steps, you won't assume he's praying, so that is classified as too many. Also, those who said three consecutive or simultaneously done, such as to move both hands and the head, both hands, like stretching, both hands and the head, three with the large organs, three movements at the same time, that will invalidate one's prayer as well. Although this is the latter saying of many scholars about the three consecutive movements, but the first saying, which lasts for a duration of one rak'ah, is stronger because it is supported with more evidence from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the hadith, it is mentioned, narrated by Ahmad and others, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was praying once, and the door of his house was closed. Aisha, his wife, came in, and the door was in the direction of the Qibla. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam moved forward, opened the door for his wife, then went back to his position and continued his prayer. This hadith, which is classified as authentic, shows that one would assume that definitely the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam performed more than two moves. So it won't be just two moves. To step one step forward, that's one step. Then to open the door, then to move back. So it won't be just two moves. That's why that backs the first saying, that what invalidates the prayer is consecutive movements that would last for a duration of one rak'ah. If they are not consecutive, this does not invalidate one's prayer. Such as in the first rak'ah, let us say he scratched his head. Then when he was in sujood, for instance, he scratched his hand. Then in the second rak'ah, he did the same. In the third rak'ah, he did the same. Here, they won't be classified as consecutive movements, and that won't invalidate one's prayer. They need to be consecutive for the prayer to be invalidated. And also, the scholar said, the consideration is by the big organs of one's body. But for instance, the movement of the fingers is not classified as multiple of movements. For instance, one extended his hand while he was standing to his head. That's one move. He started scratching his head like this, but only moving the fingers. That won't be classified as multiple movements. Or someone, let us say, was standing like this, his right hand on the left, and he started moving his finger like this or scratching his hand, but his hand is stable, fixed. Only the fingers are moving. This does not invalidate his prayer, as long as he's not doing so out of playing. Because playing negates the concept of praying. So if one is playing even by moving only his finger or by blinking his eye, for instance, fixing his button and the like, it's a small movement, little one it's classified, but that invalidates one's prayer as well. However, one movement which is classified as excessive movement invalidates one's prayer, such as jumping. Now, jumping, if a person jumps, this movement is classified as excessive. So that invalidates one's prayer as well. So although it is one movement, not three, but it is excessive. Because the one who's watching this person and seeing him jumping, he won't assume that he is praying. So that's classified as excessive. Also amongst the invalidators of the prayer is eating and drinking. According to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, let us say you ate before you prayed, then while you were praying, you had some food in your mouth, even little amount, like the sesame seed, that size, then you swallow it on purpose, that invalidates your prayer. Unless one forgot that he's praying, and the amount of food and drink that he consumed was classified as little as well, then his prayer remains valid. Now you tell me, how would one forget? It might happen. Someone was in the last sitting, let us say, he forgot to say Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. He forgot to end his prayer with Assalam. He saw in front of him food, grapes. He grabbed one and ate it. Then he remembered that he hasn't said Assalamu alaikum yet. He would be able to say Assalamu alaikum and finish his prayer, and his prayer remains valid. Even the scholar said, regarding this particular case, if one, let us say, was praying and he finished the prayer forgetfully, one rak'ah earlier. Let us say he was supposed to pray Maghrib, three rak'ahs. In the second rak'ah, he was sitting down. He said the tashahud, salah on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he said, Assalamu alaikum. Then when he stood up and he was about to leave the session, he remembered that he only performed two rak'ahs, not three. What does he need to do in that case? He needs to make up the rak'ah. He would sit down facing the qibla and make up one rak'ah. And his prayer will be valid in that case. But if it was interrupted, the time when he remembered and the time when he left the prayer was too long, then he has to restart the prayer all over again. Like for instance, he prayed two rak'ahs, then he went, he had some sandwiches, drank and the like, then he remembered, I prayed only two. He needs to restart the prayer all over again now. Once it happened that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was praying a four rak'ahs prayer, four cycles, and in the second rak'ah he made a salam. He forgot, and this is not impossible to happen to the prophets. He made a salam. Then one of the companions approached the Prophet. He said, O Messenger of Allah, has the prayer been shortened from four to two? Or Allah, look at the adab, they call it, politeness of the companions. He said, or Allah made you forget. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the companions, is it true what he's saying? That he made taslim, he finished the prayer from two rak'ahs. And they said yes. Once they said yes, the Prophet faced the qibla and made two rak'ahs. If this happens to you and you think you have finished your prayer, then you remember that you have one rak'ah to do left, or two rak'ahs. If it's a short period of time, you can just sit and get up to get the other two rak'ahs or the one rak'ah, whatever is left. If it's a long period of time, the interruption, then one needs to start the prayer all over again. Also amongst the invalidators of the prayer is for one to have the intention to interrupt the prayer. Now or later, someone is praying, and while in the prayer, he puts the intention in his heart, I want to interrupt the prayer. Someone was knocking on the door while he was praying, and he intended in his heart, I want to interrupt the prayer. His prayer becomes invalidated. Or if he intends to interrupt the prayer by making this contingent upon the occurrence of something, an incident. Let us say he was waiting for a call from overseas. He started the prayer and the phone started ringing. But in his prayer at the beginning, he had the intention after he started, if my phone rings, I'm going to interrupt my prayer and answer the call. By having this intention, that invalidates his prayer. So he intended to interrupt the prayer and he made it contingent upon the occurrence of something. Or if one hesitates whether to interrupt it or not, let us say someone is knocking on the door and he started hesitating. Should I interrupt the prayer and open the door or should I continue? By being hesitant, that invalidates one's prayer as well. Also, the scholars mentioned that amongst the invalidators of one's prayer is for one to complete an integral of the prayer while the doubt persists whether or not one established the intention to perform the prayer during the opening takbir, saying Allahu Akbar at the beginning of the prayer. Because you start the prayer by saying Allahu Akbar. And while saying Allahu Akbar, you establish the intention in your heart to pray Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, whatever the prayer is. So if one, after saying Allahu Akbar, started reciting the Fatiha. Fatiha is one integral, is an integral of the prayer. He started, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. He had a doubt. Did I intend to pray or not? He continued trying to remember, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. Still not remembering. Ihdina al-Sirat wal-Mustaqim, Sirat wal-Lazina an'amta alayhim, غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. Finished the Fatiha. Couldn't remember if he put the intention or not while saying Allahu Akbar. His prayer has become invalidated because that doubt persisted until he finished one whole integral. That's regarding the Fatiha. Or in the ruku', he went to ruku'. When does ruku' finish? When he goes back to the standing position. While in ruku', he had a doubt whether or not he put the intention to perform the prayer. He raised up from ruku' and that doubt still persisting. His prayer becomes invalidated. Or doubt persisted for a long period of time, even if no integral was made during that period of time. For instance, one recited the Fatiha, he didn't have any doubt. He started with Surah Al-Mulk. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Tabarak al-Lazi biyadihi al-Mulk. It consists of 30 ayahs. When he started, he doubted whether or not he intended to perform the prayer. He continued reciting the verses. Now, this whole surah is not an integral. It's recommended. He finished the whole surah. It takes time. So about 10 minutes while he was reciting, he was in doubt. He finished while still having this doubt. So it's a long period of time. And the doubt still persists. In that case, one's prayer is invalidated. And here we're not talking about the mere thoughts that may come to one without his will. Sometimes while you're praying, the devil might come to you and whisper to you. There is a devil. His job, his task is to whisper to one in his prayer. He would come to you and open many subjects while you are praying, trying to distract you from your prayer. So if you know yourself, for sure you had the intention to perform the prayer, but the devil was whispering, did you intend or not? You know you intended to pray, but the devil is whispering. Here you can just ignore it because you know yourself and you don't give it any attention. You continue your prayer. Finally, I would like to mention something. Some people, when they pray, they might have doubt whether they pray 2 rak'ahs or 3 rak'ahs. We'll talk about this later, but now I want to mention it because it's important. That is different from the case of doubting the intention of the opening takbir. If you doubt whether you perform 2 or 3 rak'ahs, the scholar said, you take with what you are sure you have performed so far. So if you are in doubt whether you have performed 2 or 3, you know for sure you have performed 2, but you are not sure whether you have performed the 3rd one or not. Here you would say, I want to build on this case as I have performed 2 rak'ahs, and you add up to it what completes your prayer. So when you have a doubt, always rely on the least number. Always rely on the least number and continue what is left. By this we conclude talking about the conditions of the validity of the prayer. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our prayers and to grant us sincerity in our prayers and to make us amongst those who die while being righteous. Ameen. And Allah knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.